58, 59, one of them years, we were down here in in the wintertime, surfing the breakwater, and we saw this white water way outside, you know. It's kind of spooky to see this huge thing coming out of nowhere, you know. So nobody thought of going out there in the wintertime when it was that big, you know. Jeff wanted to just ride it, you know, to see if he can do it. Not that he was want to be the only person riding there. He just wanted to ride big waves.
I've covered sports of all kinds for more than 30 years, and what Jeff Clark did out there riding that place, even if he rode it alone once, let alone 15 years or whatever it was, it is beyond my comprehension, and nothing else could compare to it. I only wish that I'd been up on the cliff to watch Jeff surf it alone, because that's one of the seminal events in the history of sports.
I was born in Redwood City. I was a descendant of a Julian Duncan Clark who moved to the Bay Area in 1916. My parents grew up on the peninsula here. My father moved our family to the beach in Half Moon Bay, Miramar, in 1966, where we built our family home about 150 feet from the water. The beach was my playground. My dad fished, and my brothers fished, and you know, it became our family homestead at the beach. There'd be these guys showing up in the Volkswagen buses with surfboards on the roof. I was the little gnat that would keep walking around, looking at everything, and finally one of those guys gave me a surfboard. I started surfing. The better I got at surfing, the more I started to explore. Surfing all the different breaks and discovering new breaks and surfing the cove just north of Mavericks was where I spent most of my time with a guy, Brian Heafy.
Jeff would say, you know, you want to go surf? I go, let's go. And we'd go up there and we'd walk down this big cliff and surf Ross's Cove. And that was inside of Mavericks, of course.
Mavericks would start to break over on the south side of the point. And we'd head over there and we'd watch it, you know, someday. Just thinking someday, you know. Brian, someday I'm gonna go out there. And, you know, and finally that day came in 1975. And I'm like, Brian, let's go out there.
It was kind of foggy, so I said, I'd rather not, you know. And he goes, okay, I'm gonna go out. But it was the first time he went out, so it was kind of scary, spooky, I imagine.
I start paddling through the reef, and there was a lot of pressure coming from the north side. I was just paddling, there were rocks around me. I wasn't giving up, I was getting out there. What I noticed right away was how loud these waves were. I mean, just shocking vibration through your body of the water displacing, just exploding. And I'm like, okay. I finally got myself into position. I paddled for one, and the thing just, it was like going up in an elevator, you know? The thing was jacking up so hard to break. And I thought, okay, I gotta get in the vein of that original lift. And I did, and I hit my feet, and it was just like, it was dark. As I started going down this wave and I could feel every imperfection in the bottom of my surfboard, I was going so fast. And I just went straight, ran out, because the thing sucked me up and it was like holding me there. So I was just trying to get away because I didn't want to get hit by this explosion chasing me. And boom, I heard it hit behind me and I got away and I was like, ooh. You know, I just turned out and got on the shoulder and paddled back out. And you know, your heart's going, wah, you know, going 180 miles an hour, you know. And it's like, okay, I can do this.
Mavericks, incredible place that went unknown for God knows how long, you know. All of a sudden, we're starting to hear these stories drifting back about Half Moon Bay and this place hidden behind San Francisco with these outrageously big waves, and this guy named Jeff Clark, and he's riding waves that are so mean and so nasty by himself that nobody even wants to go in the goddamn water with him, and he does it not for a season, but several seasons before he could get anybody to go out.
I got a 9'10" big wave gun, and everybody else stuck with their 7-foot boards that they'd ride every day. Once it was time to surf Mavericks, everybody said, "Nah, it's okay. I got things to do. I got polish the car." From the early days at surfing at Mavericks, when I took Dave Schmidt and Tom Powers out there, and they went back to Santa Cruz, and word spread like wildfire. The next time it broke, everybody that had a board over 8 feet was, most of these guys had Sunset Beach and Waimea experience. They were coming up, and it was like there were 12 guys out at Mavericks, and I was like, wow, who are all these people in my living room?
The first day that I had surfed that I actually got out and got waves was, I remember Richard Schmidt and his brother Dave was out, and Jeff, and a couple friends of mine, Matt Ambrose, Jim Kibblewhite. That was the first day I was getting waves. I got a bunch of waves that day, and I was on that board that I had was only an 8'2".
It was in January of 1992. It was my first session, and it was huge and unbelievable, like really stunning, and it's kind of a high-profile session. There was a lot of good swells that month, and Richard Schmidt was back from Hawaii, and he was sort of the rock star of our coast. He was by far the most credible big wave guy around. And here he comes and saying, "No, this is as scary as Waimea on the biggest day."
1994 is the week, man. It's just, we saw this swell coming, and it looked really good, and we're in a really good weather pattern. The wind's blowing straight offshore. December can be all-time good surf on the north coast of California.
Monday the 19th is when Mavericks broke big and howling offshore. It's when Jay Moriarty took that wipeout for the ages, forever frozen in time by the Bob Barber photograph. And that was a truly horrifying day. It was just one trip over the falls after another, one terrifying wipeout after another. Guys being stuck up in the top of the wave, literally being blown out the top by the wind and unable to get back down, and then just dying one after another. Lemmings over the cliff, as it was described. I got out there on Wednesday the 19th and spent the whole day there. It wasn't quite as offshore, and that was a significant day because there was a lot of good surfing went on that day. And it was just as big. It was full on Mavericks, great conditions. But guys like Evan Slater and Peter Mel started to make the waves, and they were surfing it pretty well. And there were obviously some death-defying wipeouts, but it was a day where a little bit of progress was made, and guys got a little bit of handle of where to take off, how to do it, how to make the drop, and some really great things happened that day. And then finally, Friday the 23rd is the day that Mark Fu died, which was a deceptively dangerous day.
On that big day, you had a lot of guys come. You had Mark Fu come, you had Kenny Bradshaw, Brock was there. So they all converged together this day. And here, for the first time, you could see their interaction by the top Mavericks riders and the best of that Hawaii has to offer.
But it was also an extremely beautiful day, almost a surrealistic day for our part of the country, because it was beautiful, it was hot, people had their shirts off. It was never more crowded from a media standpoint than it was that day. There were helicopters in the sky, the cliff was filled with media people, so was the water, the channel had boats full of media people, and there was a ton of havoc that day. Brock Little and Mike Parsons almost died on the same wave.
This place is nasty, and it's going to take some, it's going to take some dealing with. I've talked to all the guys, and believe me, the place left an impression on the boys. And then, of course, you had Brock almost eat it. He got his leash tangled up inside. And he told me flat out, face to face, that's close sign we're coming to drown him. And this guy's ridden some ridiculous off the chart stuff in the islands. And the stories kind of go on. And then, of course, the tragedy of Mark catching that wave. And I mean, here's a guy that's one of the most renowned big wave riders in the world, and he catches a wave. And Mark Fu said on many occasions, how does that saying go? If you're gonna dance, you gotta pay the piper. And unfortunately, Mark paid.
It was just weird how it all kind of came down. Like, there was this like 8 to 12 day, whatever it was, series of swells, and it had sunny weather, and at the end of it, when he had passed away, you almost like you could feel like this weird presence of, you know, somebody greater than us coming in and taking him. I know that, you know, there was a lot of talk going back and forth about Mavericks not being heavy as Waimea and Todos, and all this stuff was going, you know, everyone was like, oh, Waimea's way heavier, or Todos is way gnarlier, but I think Mavericks, in a weird kind of like, almost don't even want to say it way, just went, no, I'm the heaviest.
Mavericks came out of the, you know, the woodwork, and no one had heard of it, and then it was this, you know, very prominent blotch on every surf magazine for the next few years, and it was an obvious place for a contest to be held, because Waimea Bay, the, you know, Mount Everest of surfing until then, had sort of had this high profile big wave challenge every year, and the company that sponsored that decided, yeah, let's do one at Mavericks, and kind of made an arrangement with Jeff to do it. And I think at that time, you know, all of us were psyched.
The Men Who Ride Mountains was the first event, and it was kind of crazy, the first event. You know, it was late in the season, and finally, the swell that we were looking for came. Kind of a, you got one shot at this, give it a go. You know, you got 1 hour to show your stuff, and Flea won the first contest. The second contest comes around. This contest has waves that are 40 to 50 foot faces in it. And it is off the hook, power. I remember being, you know, I'm the contest director, so I'm cruising around in my Zodiac, and Kelly Slater's in this contest, Ross Clark Jones, Tony Ray, Brock Little. Just a great, great lineup of surfers. I remember the Hawaiians just going, does it ever shut off? It was a very intense contest. And Flea won the second contest.
Mavericks is Mavericks. It didn't really change. What changed was the perception of Mavericks and the way it was thought of by the top guys in the world that ride big waves. And overnight, one day, it gained everybody's respect from Hawaii. And so what more can you say? You know, you got Jaws, you got thing in Tahiti that wants to just eat your ass, and Laird Caught, you got Waimea, you got Sunset, and guess what? Now you got Mavericks.